First responders often find themselves in harm's way, responding to active shooters, fires, violent patients. But the danger they're facing now, all across the globe, is a microscopic one. As COVID-19, a type of coronavirus that can cause severe respiratory infection, spreads throughout the world, EMTs, paramedics, firefighters, and potentially law enforcement officers are finding themselves on the front lines of this global pandemic. Already, reports are flooding in of dozens of responders testing positive for the virus. As a responder, taking the necessary precautions to prevent yourself from getting infected is of paramount importance. Fortunately, there's an NFPA standard available that can help. Welcome to Learn Something New by NFPA Journal. NFPA 1581, Standard on a Fire Department Infection Control Program, has been around since the early 90s. The current 2015 edition of the standard is available for free online at nfpa.org/1581. If you don't have time to read through it all, though, this video will give you some key takeaways from the document. 1. It's for everybody. The standard says fire department, but in actuality, it applies to any first responder entering a situation where infection transmission could occur. Here's NFPA Emergency Services Specialist John Montez discussing this on a recent NFPA Journal podcast.
You should be using 1581, even if you're not a fire department. I know it says for fire departments, and that's the standard for infection control programs for fire departments, because 1581 has droplet precautions. It has all the information on disposal, what plans and policies you need in place for infection control. So responder organizations across the board, fire, EMS, law, even dispatch, should all be following 1581.
2. Designating an ICO or infection control officer. According to NFPA 1581, departments should have a part or full-time employee serving as the ICO to manage all aspects of infection control, from guidance on personal protective equipment to post-incident management and cleaning. This person must be knowledgeable and cognizant of infectious disease pathogens, from bioterrorism weapons like anthrax to emerging infectious diseases like SARS or COVID-19. One way this knowledge is ensured is through the ICO maintaining a strong relationship with local medical and public health officials. 3. Using personal protective equipment. NFPA 1581 requires departments to keep infection-preventing PPE, such as gloves, eyewear, and masks, aboard all department vehicles that support EMS operations. With the exception of a mask, that PPE should be removed when you then go to operate a vehicle, and new PPE should be donned if you need to again assist with patient care. The level of PPE needed to prevent infection obviously varies depending on the nature of the pathogen. Tuberculosis, for example, is much easier to transmit than HIV. Therefore, a respirator mask like an N95 is needed to protect yourself from TB. For COVID-19, responders should be using what's known as droplet protection. Here's John Montez again.
Droplet protection. So that equals gloves, a gown, a respirator, N95 or P100, and a face shield and eye protection.
It's important to also limit exposure. By minimizing the number of members needed on a call and limiting the number of members interacting with a patient, you limit the potential exposure to and spread of infection. 4. Cleaning yourself and your PPE. Unless you've been living under a rock for the past 2 weeks, you've heard it over and over again. Wash your hands, wash your hands, wash your hands. And in NFPA 1581, the message is no different. Responders must wash their hands after every emergency medical call, after cleaning PPE, and so on. When hand washing isn't an option, using a hand sanitizing solution that is at least 60% alcohol is a suitable alternative. The standard also offers very detailed instructions on how to clean and disinfect PPE. It indicates, for example, that there shall even be additional PPE used to clean your incident PPE, including splash-resistant eyewear, cleaning gloves, and fluid-resistant clothing. These 4 takeaways were just a small portion of the pertinent and timely information available in NFPA 1581. Again, the full standard is available for free online at nfpa.org/1581, and there are links to other relevant NFPA resources in the description of this video. Thanks for watching, and be sure to subscribe to NFPA's YouTube channel for more content like this.